Hello, in this episode of Bug Bounty Reports Explained, I will cover my own bug, a $1,500 SSRF in Stripe. And the good thing about explaining my own reports is that not only I will tell you what the bug was, but also how I chose the target, how I tested it, what tools did I use, and so on. So enjoy the explanation. Before I start, a quick announcement about BBRE Premium. From June, the price goes up. It doesn't affect current members, so if you subscribe in May, you will lock in the current low price forever. I also migrated BBRE Premium to a new platform recently, and now you can subscribe using PayPal. If you've been thinking about it for a while, this is the best time to join BBRE Premium. Smokescreen is Stripe's open source tool that proxies traffic to the external world. In simple words, I have integrations that wait for new BBRE Premium subscribers. When you subscribe, Stripe's server finds what webhooks I've configured for this event and sends the request with that information to my server. Where is Smokescreen in this process? It's between Stripe's server and the external world. It makes sure that if I will add, let's say, a cloud metadata endpoint or localhost as the webhook address, no request will be sent there. Only the public internet is allowed. The particular behavior is based on Smokescreen rules that Stripe's developers created. When doing my 100 hours bug bounty challenge on Stripe, I saw very early that the whole organization's GitHub is in scope. But at the beginning, I did not want to test Smokescreen. The idea of bypassing domain or IP validation in a tool that's created strictly for this purpose seemed like a tall order. I prefer to attack applications where developers don't expect it. In this case, it was an eye-to-eye duel. But after about 70 hours and weeks without finding a bug, I decided to take a look. It's an open source tool, so instead of blindly adding another webhook endpoints, I prefer to set up my environment and, apart from just reading the code, debug the application as it runs. I set it up on macOS without any VMs or containers. This is the access control list that I used for testing. And I have no idea what these services, projects, and roles mean. I only used default rules because the same code is used for comparisons anyway. I was switching between allow lists and deny lists. And this is my config file, which just makes sure that I don't have to use any role, whatever it is. And finally, this is the curl command to send a request through the proxy. If it's denied, you get an error. Otherwise, you just see example.com. The first thing I wanted to check was DNS rebinding. I spent several hours understanding the protections, as it's programmed the way I've never seen before, but I wasn't able to find anything wrong there. So I went on, and I wanted to find the code responsible for comparing domain names. So first, I noticed check if request should be proxied function, so I put a breakpoint there. But all it does is call check ACLs for request and handles its response. So I jumped to that function. It also handles some metrics, logging, but it does not contain the logic of comparing a domain or an IP address. So I stepped into the decide function, which sounds more interesting. This one checks different rules one by one. And finally, there is the host matches glob function, which contains the actual comparison of one domain to the other. Of course, the first time I was doing that, it took me much more time to figure all this out, and I was also checking out what other functions are doing. The host matches glob function takes two arguments, host and domain glob. Host is our potentially malicious host. Domain glob is the rule. It can be a literal domain or a domain with wildcard subdomains. This function only checks if those match, and it does not care whether it's an allow list or deny list. When the domain glob is not a wildcard, there is a simple equals equals comparison. As simple as that. If there is a wildcard, it checks if our host ends with the domain glob. So these rules are quite strict. I did not come up with a way to bypass an allow list. But what about a deny list? Have you ever noticed that when making a DNS query, there is always the dot at the end? For a long time, I didn't really care what it means. But it's actually quite significant. DNS is divided into zones. If you create your own zone, you have control over DNS inside. The internet is under the root zone, indicated by the trailing dot at the end. So when you visit example.com with the trailing dot at the end, it's a proper absolute domain name. But usually you visit example.com without the dot. From HTTP or rather HTTPS protocol standpoint, some websites work with both, but others, including mine, don't work with HTTPS with trailing dots. Without the dot, it's a relative domain name, but the dot is implicitly appended in your DNS search list. So coming back to the validation, by using the trailing dot, you could bypass domain deny list. We can confirm this by stepping into the function and evaluating that host and domain glob are not equal in this case. The same attack works if the rule forbids traffic to a wildcard subdomain. Before I submitted the report, I've checked if any tools like curl, Python's requests or browsers will strip this dot when making a request, but no. So what can you do by bypassing a domain deny list? The truth is, this is much less impactful than bypassing IP deny list. But that's what I like about testing open source tools. Not only do I have the local debugging setup, but also I have more possibilities. You see, if I was only testing Stripe.com, there would either be an SSRF there or not. In this case, not. But when testing an open source tool that's also used by other organizations, you only need to find one configuration where the bug exists. Of course, it can't be a super unlikely scenario, but you still have much more freedom. So even though this was only exploitable in a specific configuration, Stripe rewarded me with $500 of base payout plus $1,000 bonus for finding the bug in the critical piece of their infrastructure. As for the fix, dots are now trimmed from the right before the comparison. We can see that when using the same command as previously, host and domain glob are still not the same, but the new trimmed variables are, so the attack is not possible. Also, the domains are lowercased before the comparison. I spent a while trying to come up with some kind of Unicode collision attack on this lowercasing process, but I couldn't make the attack work. If you want to learn more about debugging, check out my presentation from NahamCon about the topic. Also, I'm covering debugging in BBRE Premium. If you want to check it out, go to bbre.dev/premium. Just make sure to join before the price rises. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.